Good morning. Good morning and welcome to this beautiful Naples morning. So good that you could be with us. I'm glad to have you, glad to be here with you. I'm especially glad to be here with those who are in the sanctuary, though we miss you. Daniel Goodsit in the AV room, John Forsyth, Stu Shelton at the piano this morning, our stewardship chair, Robin Petty, and our worship associate this morning, Joanne Husky.
Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Greater Naples. My name is Joanne Husky, and I'm your worship associate this morning. Whether you're watching live on YouTube or on Facebook Live this morning, or whether you're catching this later during the week, please know that you are always welcome here. If you are watching this live today, you may want to communicate with other people in the community who are watching by using the chat button on the side. And please note, this morning is our last morning that we will be, our last Sunday that we'll be using YouTube. From now on, we'll be on Facebook Live, and you don't have to be on Facebook to use it. You can get the link on our website or in the weekly news. Our mission statement states that we are a welcoming congregation, freely seeking spiritual and intellectual growth. We strive to create a larger community of peace, justice, and love. If you have joined us since the pandemic and are interested in getting on our mailing list or learning more about this wonderful congregation, please check out our website or send us an email at office@uunaples.org. We would love to hear from you. There really is a lot going on here, despite the fact that we have been separated for such a long time. So please take a look at your email notices that are coming out each week, which give you lots of opportunities for fellowship and learning and ways to commune with our congregation. You can also check out our UUCGN Virtual Coffee Hour Facebook page if you want to chat with people in the congregation. I have a couple of special announcements to make this morning. Our Mindful Mondays Forum continues this Monday at 7 o'clock with Dr. Charles Kupchella, whose topic is anti-intellectualism and anti-science sentiment in America. And this year's Progressive Voices, which is our annual speaker series, will be the next four Wednesdays on Zoom. Jim Kenney, a well-loved speaker, will host four webinars on Wednesday, February 3rd, 10th, 17th, and 24th. This series is called Diagnosing Our Political Infection, and we'll look at the problems that we are facing, both in a historical and in a regional context. You can register on our UUCGN website if you'd like to attend. Details for these and so many other things are available in our weekly mailing, so please make sure you're on the mailing list. Today, we are focusing on the many volunteers who contribute to this vibrant congregation. One of those is Robin Petty, who is heading up our pledge campaign this year. Let's hear a bit from Robin about why this pledge campaign is important to all of us. Robin?
Thank you, Joanne. Good morning. It's my pleasure to report back to you all on our current pledge campaign for the fiscal year that will start next April. Out of our 250 pledge units, we have heard from 174 of you, pledging a total of $376,000 for the next fiscal year. That includes about $34,000 of pledge increases, for which we are truly grateful, particularly since that will essentially offset the $35,000 of pledge reductions we've had. This is mostly partly because of members that we've lost for one reason or another, and partly because of members who've felt they had to cut back on their pledge this year. But bearing in mind that we are truly grateful for the matching grant that we have in place that will essentially offset those reductions. The pledge total for the current fiscal year is $438,000, and it remains to be seen if we'll be able to match that from the 76 pledge units that are still outstanding, but we will be following up with you and calling you this coming week. I should not overlook the pledges that come to us from non-member friends of the congregation. And that amounts to essentially about $10,000 so far. So that's kind of the raw numbers. But the work of this congregation goes on, and your commitment to it remains as essential as always, even though we're not here together to enjoy each other's presence. Although I think we'll probably see some reduction in our expenses due to the COVID crisis, we all have to bear in mind that we will have upcoming commitments for capital replacements, which I think I outlined to you last week. And bear in mind that we will need to fund the minister's sabbatical, which will also take place in the next fiscal year. I wouldn't want to step away from this without thanking my compadre, Susan Music, who has been a constant source of thought, ideas, inspiration, and counsel. Particularly, though, I want to thank Anna in the office, who really did all the heavy lifting here. She's all the messaging, all the data, that she's kept us absolutely current on everything going on here. It remains only for me to say that I look forward to the time when I can look out and see your smiling faces in a sea of faces here. And other than that, to express profound regret that we won't get to party after this one. So hopefully next time around, we will. Thank you very much for your support.
Thanks, Robin. And so let us settle joyfully into our time together in worship with this morning's prelude. Thanks, Stu. Remembering that Sunny Side of the Street was written during a time when things were difficult. So we celebrate this morning the end of a pledge drive, the end of a difficult January, by lifting our spirits, and very much appreciative of that. We come to this place bearing gifts, whether online or in person. The gift of our experience, the gift of our wisdom, the gift of our time, the gift of our hope, the gift of our presence. Sometimes we come with joy in our hearts. Other times we don't feel we have much to offer. We come more in need. We arrive tired. Perhaps we come angry. Occasionally we come in grief. It is then that our combined gifts work their miracles. A knowing look offered in understanding, a helping hand grasped in gratitude, a healing word given and received. Whether online or in person, we come to this time bearing gifts, the gift of ourselves, offered in humility and in love, in community. Let's join together in our responsive to the chalice lighting words on the screen. In the light of truth, the warmth of community and the fire of commitment we gather this day. May the flame we now kindle be to us a symbol of the unity we seek. And I will imagine you rising at home and singing along with the words on the screen this morning, Jim Scott's words to gather the Spirit.
Gather the Spirit, harvest the power, our separate fires will kindle one flame. Witness the mystery of this hour. Our trials in this light appear all the same. Gather in peace, gather in thanks, gather in sympathy now and then. Gather in hope, compassion, and strength. Gather to celebrate. Once again, gather the spirit of heart and mind. Seeds for the sowing are laid in store, nurtured in love and conscience refined, with body and spirit united once more. Gather in peace, gather in thanks. Gather in sympathy now and then. Gather in hope, compassion, and strength. Gather to celebrate once again.
A few weeks ago, a number of people gathered for a first Friday that happened to happen on a second Friday, but a Zoom gathering of as many people that wanted to join, mostly to join in fellowship, to see one another online, if not in person, and to celebrate a bit of this community. And during that gathering, Bobby Berglund had prepared a video to show under the guidance of Robin Petty, who maybe suggested it. And what we want to do this morning is share that video for those of you who haven't seen it, showing what's been going on here during the pandemic. Let's go with that.
Resilience. Look what's been happening while you have been away. Our last in-person service was in March. Since then, we've been streaming and Zooming to stay in touch. Does this look familiar? While we have been gone from our church building, the UUCGN staff members and friends have been busy. Here's a snapshot of some of the things that have been going on while we have been apart. In May, 21 members of our congregation attended the first virtual meeting of the Unitarian Universalist Association General Assembly. It was supposed to be held in Providence, Rhode Island, but the virus mandated that it become virtual, and that actually allowed many more participants from our congregation. Registration costs were supported by the Congregational Engagement Fund. We were able to listen to many engaging speakers and chat with others in attendance from across the country. Following the assembly, we wrote reviews of our sessions and shared them with all participants. Your hardworking board of trustees and minister have met at least monthly. And program council has also met monthly. The council includes chairs of all committees. Each month, we focus on one or more of the committees to understand what they are doing and offer our help if needed. Our newest is the Book Buddies Online program, an outgrowth of Emerson Academy, one of our incredible social justice initiatives. Here's a look at some of the additional work ongoing while we are apart. The Facilities Committee has been busy doing the following to be ready for our return. Board member Bill Nicholson has been working closely with David Bosworth, our sexton, to transform the many areas of the church for your safety, convenience, and aesthetic pleasure. Touchless water faucets have been added to the bathrooms. Touchless towel dispensers are awaiting you. And you will find automatic hand sanitizers throughout the building. When you are thirsty, you may use one of our touchless water fountains. And here is David demonstrating their use. Additional security cameras have been added so that our property can be more fully monitored on site as well as remotely. And all the lighting has been changed to LED, so things will look brighter when you return. If you had the opportunity to access our storage areas in the past, you will be impressed with their transformation. Here is the closet where the AV equipment is located. And here's the closet down the hall. David has devised an easy way to keep our supplies separated from those of the Jewish congregation who use the same space. You may note that it's easy now to see our supplies and determine what additions are needed. Cleaning the closets and organizing the materials for best accessibility has been a focus. If you volunteered for the Hospitality Committee in the past, or you've worked in our kitchen in some other capacity, you'll be impressed with the cleanliness that has been achieved there. The refrigerators and stoves have been moved out, cleaned, and returned to their original position. The whole kitchen is sparkling. David has also done much painting in the building, and more is planned. You can see the colors by taking a look at David's clothing. And for beauty, our amazing and dedicated garden crew has maintained a beautiful meditation and memorial space and inviting areas for strolling and viewing the lovely and ever-changing flowers that grace our property. Our beautiful waterfall is always the source of inspiration and peace. Here are a few examples of the incredible orchids you will find on your garden stroll. We also have a wide variety of bromeliads that add color and dimension to the garden. If you haven't found Fred's place, you must do so. And please inquire about it from the garden crew if you need to know about its meaning. It's a very special story. The Caring Committee has continued to call people and check in, especially with those who may be living alone or dealing with medical issues. The lovely cards created by Christina and George Wright have been greatly appreciated. George is the gifted photographer, and here's an example of the lovely work that has been sent to many people in the congregation. The membership committee has been busy surveying other UU congregations regarding their membership practices, and they have developed multiple ideas for implementation in our congregation. They also strongly support a new website for UUCGN, as they found that people generally find us by looking at the web before they ever come in the door. The Personnel Committee has employed our new music coordinator, Stu Shelton, and they've also developed the COVID-19 guidelines as well as the pavilion usage guidelines. Currently, they are conducting personnel evaluations. Technology is one of the biggest changes you may notice when you return. In fact, you are already enjoying the additional lights and cameras being used to stream our Sunday service. The next several photos show the installation work. Here is the additional wiring and equipment housed in the AV room just off the sanctuary. We are grateful to the support of the Peggy and Bill Green Fund and the Endowment Fund for making these upgrades possible. Here are the additional lights being installed in the ceiling of the sanctuary. A lift was required to get the equipment and the lights up there. And while it was on the property, wiring was also installed in Thomas Hall and on the pavilion to be ready for future use. Currently, services are being streamed on YouTube and Facebook. Also, the UUCGN Facebook page has been redone so that many more are able to use it. Here's our AV technician, Daniel Goodset, looking happy at his new control, and our technology chair, John Forsyth, both on the job, making sure you can see the services as planned. The committee is also leading a plan for developing a new website for the congregation that will be easy to use and inviting to members and friends. Forum moved from Sunday mornings to Monday nights. Regular forum webinars are being held on multiple topics. Here are slides of the forum chair, Flo Beckler, and screens that were shared during one of the webinars regarding the separation of church and state. Jean Goldberg was the moderator for this particular evening. Music committee members have worked closely with Reverend Tony to plan and deliver incredible music for our services. And they recently welcomed Stu Shelton on board as our music coordinator. They also provided an evening of music for the holidays, sharing their multiple talents with us via Zoom. The hardworking and talented team on the Adult Enrichment Committee have offered a wide-ranging set of programs, wonderful Wednesdays, including stories from you, chalice circles, book clubs, daily yoga, regular meditation, and many other experiences you may have participated in. Tarot, our team against racism and oppression, our newest committee, led a small group in reading and discussing the UUA Common Read this year, The Indigenous People's History of the United States. Currently, the team is offering book discussion groups related to our anti-racism initiative. Anna, our congregational administrator, has been hard at work in the office and working remotely as well to produce the regular notices about the Sunday service, the monthly newsletter, and other communications. She also answers the phone and handles emails and also works closely with the comptroller and the treasurer and generally keeps things moving along. So you can see that in spite of our physical separation, we are a resilient group, and we are working hard to keep our congregation active, interested, and engaged during this challenging time. We are all looking forward to returning to our lovely campus and reconnecting in.
Reconnecting in so many ways. We're grateful for Bobby for just pulling that all together. It took a lot of work, and grateful for everyone who were highlighted in that video. Let's center ourselves now with our centering hymn, What Gift Can We Bring? Words and Music by Jane Marshall.
What gift can we bring? What present, what token? What words can convey it, the joy of this day? When grateful we come, Remembering, rejoicing, what song can we offer in honor and praise? Give thanks for the past, for those who had vision, who planted and watered so dreams could come true. Give thanks for the now, for study, for worship, for mission that bids us turn prayer into deed. This gift we now bring, this present, this token, these words can convey it, the joy of this day. When grateful we come, remembering, rejoicing, this song we now offer in honor and praise.
So many joys in that video to celebrate all the people who were highlighted and all those who were not necessarily mentioned, but who work steadily behind the scenes some to make things happen around here. The joy of this day. As we center ourselves into joys and sorrows, we honor that all of us are struggling during these times, still anxious over our national situation, whether it be political or health-wise, our local situation, our own lives. We honor that each and every one of us feels some degree of isolation in this separation. Though we may venture out into the world, we cannot gather in this community, which gives us so much sustenance. If you have a joy or a sorrow that you would like to share with the congregation, I urge you to send me an email and we'll include it in the weekly caring corner that goes out usually on a Tuesday morning. But in this moment, if you've got somebody in your heart and your mind that you've been thinking about, someone who you're concerned about, I hope that you'll take a moment and maybe light a candle or speak their name out loud. This morning, I will share the name of Perry Gotsis, who is recovering, hopefully successfully, so far so good, from significant surgery up in Massachusetts. He'll be recovering in hospital and then perhaps in rehab until he can join his daughter in Cambridge and complete his recovery there before returning to Naples. So we send our love to Perry up north, where it's very cold. We're grateful that Glenn Looney is back home and in comfortable surroundings with some help, again recovering from a bout with pneumonia that literally took his breath away. So we're grateful he's home. With all that spoken, let's enter into a time of shared meditation. Spirit of life and love, we honor the names of those who are spoken here and at home, the names of those held in silence. We express our gratitude for this community where we can freely share of our joys and sorrows, whether that be in person or over the phone or on the chat. This community where we can share deeply of ourselves, the whole of who we are on our good days and bad, our best selves, and those parts of ourselves with which we struggle. On this particular day, we honor all of you who have answered the call to service, who have given the gift of your time and your talent for the well-being of this community in all its breadth and depth. Whether you felt ready or not, you stepped up when you saw a need. And we honor you. whether you perform in the limelight or you prefer to work behind the scenes. Night or day, on weekends, on holidays, you rolled up your sleeves and pitched in, doing what was needed for this community. Sometimes with the help of many hands, sometimes alone, you gave of yourself. And we share this moment of gratitude for all who have done so. We honor your loved ones who supported those efforts, worried for you when things piled up, and grumbled occasionally, maybe, with the extent of your time given. And for all the gifts, great and small, given this day and every day for this congregation, we're grateful. And we sit in peaceful gratitude.
First reading is by Marge Piercy, To Be of Use. The people I love best jump into work headfirst, without dallying in the shallows, and swim off with sure strokes, almost out of sight. They seem to become natives in that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass along the bags, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm. When the food must come in or the fire must be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust, but the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amorphous for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real. Now is the time to express our gratitude for this community, for its work, its vision, and the many ways it has nurtured our lives. This year's pledge drive ends this morning, and we hope you will continue to support us in the coming year and help us prepare for a time when we will all be able to be together again. If you have pledged, we thank you. If you haven't, you still have time. Your morning's offering for the ongoing mission of this amazing congregation will be gratefully received. Please mail your contribution today. You can find our address and a lot more about this congregation at www.uunaples.org. You may not know this, but UUCGN's glue is found in the many volunteers who make this place a special place. You'd be amazed at how many people give their time and energy to this community. Even during this pandemic, people in this congregation have been working hard to build and sustain our community. As you could see from Bobby Berglund's film, there are so many people involved in UUCGN. They share their time and their expertise. It truly does take a village. Why, you may ask, do people volunteer? After all, you may have worked hard all your life and you've finally retired. It's time to relax. Besides, I mean, who wants to work for free? But I can vouch for the fact that people who volunteer gain as much back as they give. By volunteering, we learn new skills. We're able to share our wisdom, our talents, our ideas. We meet interesting people of many varying backgrounds. We have a sense of belonging to something that is larger than ourselves. We make friends. We expand our mind and we stretch our abilities. We feel productive and alive. We grow in mind and in spirit. Reverend Tony asked me to tell you about why I volunteer. As you can see, I am a worship associate. I'm a member of the Worship Associates Committee. I joined the committee because I really care about the quality of our Sunday services, and I want to have a role in shaping and contributing to them. As a worship associate, I've been able to craft many Sunday services with Tony. It's really a creative process. We first discuss a theme that responds to the time in history, or to the season, or to some real life experiences that our congregation is going through right now. We search to figure out what music would go with that theme and what readings complement the message, always keeping in mind how to nurture as well as inspire our members. With COVID vaccine, we've had the additional challenge of making the digital productions both interesting and diverse, while still maintaining some kind of close connection with all of you, the viewers. All of this has been a learning process that has given me the chance to explore my presentation skills and grow both spiritually and intellectually. In addition to this committee, I've had the opportunity to speak to the whole congregation in a forum about my life as a diplomat, to tell my life story in an Odyssey evening, and to share a tale in the storytelling night. All of these were a chance for me to reflect and think about my own life and hone and share some of the insights I have. So these and other volunteer opportunities have bring me closer to all of you and make me feel known as a welcome member of this community. So, I'm lost. Sorry. Oh. So if you haven't volunteered, I highly urge you to try it out. Giving your ideas and your expertise to our community can only make us better. Gathering together with energies from all of us brings us to a higher place. So try it out. You might like it. And in fact, you might learn something. Thank you.
Thank you, Joanne, very much. And thank you, Robin, again, for your work as stewardship chair. It is not an easy task to do or to run a pledge campaign in the middle of a pandemic. So we honor you and the team for all the work that you've done. Like all Unitarian Universalist congregations, this is, in fact, a voluntary association that depends entirely on donations, not just of our financial resources, but especially of our time and our talent. This place, this incredible facility, but more important, this somewhat intangible thing we call community, has been created solely on the shoulders of people like you and me who submerged in the task and did what needed to be done again and again. Folks who wanted to be with others, to build a community dedicated to something greater than themselves. Though the initial steps in the life of this congregation took place 45 years ago this year, every step, every person who put themselves forward to move things along since then have helped make this a vibrant community, and their legacy is tangible. Whether they were ready or not, once they dipped into their toes into congregational life, once they moved past their initial jitters and settling in times and found themselves participating, even in the smallest way, they began to understand what others before them already knew, that it feels good to be a part of something more. And even beyond that feeling, extraordinary feeling of connectedness, diving in produces, as Joanne said, many opportunities to learn about ourselves, not just our strengths, but also our weaknesses, and to engage those strengths and weaknesses in community so that we can grow, learning many skills along the way, not the least of which could be patience and listening. Even beyond that, getting involved provides opportunities for enrichment in terms of relationships, deepening and growing friendships here within community. One of the things I haven't been able to do this year, because you haven't been here, is to walk out into the sanctuary on a Sunday morning and say, "Why are you here?" And often when I've done that, which usually is at least once a year, I get a wonderful array of responses. People who are willing or ready to tell their spiritual journeys, people who are simply say, "I wanted to go someplace today." The breadth of reasons that people come here and the reasons people stay are quite extraordinary. And since I haven't been able to do that, I was reflecting on it and thought about a play in which I took part a number of years ago, written by the spouse of one of my ministerial mentors, the Reverend Helen Cohen, and her husband, the playwright Don Cohen. He wrote a play about congregational life in which he did wonderful, created wonderful depictions of members of a congregation that somehow seemed familiar but weren't specific enough to be attributed to any one person. I played the role of a young minister, which would tell you how long ago this play was. But what was great about it is the clear depictions of the complexity of individuals within a congregation, but also the sense of connectedness and how important that community was in their lives, regardless of why they were there or why they stayed. That sense, as Joanne said, of the glue that a community brings. At the best of times in a congregation, there is always that sense of glue, of being in sync with one another, where there are larger parts to play and smaller one, where different roles hold the stage at different times, but where dialogue is all. And while each actor is still focused on their individual part, they also know that it is the ensemble that matters and that what they are creating together will hopefully rise above the sum of its parts. And so it is here within this congregation. And almost as soon as you begin to play a part, you feel you have a stake in what's going on. And as you move forward, you feel a little bit more empowered that this place becomes your home, and you begin to infuse it with your own values while taking in the ideas and thoughts of other people. Weeding in the garden or attending a committee meeting on Zoom may seem far removed from the Sunday morning message, but it's these activities which, and so many others, that we practice what we preach or don't. The Reverend Alice Blair Wesley, UU historian of UU history and who has also written extensively on congregational life, suggests that the day-to-day patterns in the organizational life of a congregation speak far more powerfully to its mission than any carefully crafted statement ever could. So today, without the possibility of the after-service celebration that Robin mentioned, be it a barbecue or a brunch or the bouncy house for the kids, we celebrate all of you who, despite the pandemic, continued to build community and shape this place. We are so grateful. Whether it be being present online on a Sunday morning or filling out your pledge card by working, participating, Zooming, planning, living the principles through your day-to-day actions, whether it's by doing any of all of those things, you have given the greatest gift you possibly could, the gift of yourself. And for that, collectively, we can be grateful. It is worthy of our celebration this morning. Our benediction echoes the words of our opening this morning. Whether online or in person, you have come to this time and this place bearing gifts. The gift of yourself, the gift of your open mind, your loving heart, your helping hands, the gift of your time and your talent and your treasure, offered to one another in humility and in love. We all come to this moment as recipients of the gifts others have freely given those who came before us, given to make this community what it is. And so as we go forth, let us dedicate ourselves anew to building and maintaining this community and to widening the circle of peace and justice and love that is our mission. Go forth in peace and love. I miss you. I hope to see you soon. Have a wonderful day.